friends, greetings on this Good Friday. And I was just having a little conversation with David Manx, and David was explaining to me something that I didn't know and he didn't know. We've both been to theological college, that good was actually is actually derived from the word holy. So it's Holy Friday. So greetings to each and every one of you. I'll explain a little bit in a moment how the service is going to go forward. But a special welcome to you if you're visiting or have just dropped in for this service. A couple of things to share with you before we go any further. If you wish to make an offering, there is a plate at the rear of the church. You might like to have a look at Dorothy Barth's wonderful display, I guess is the right word, of the cross, which is in the foyer there, just in the hallway. And also, if any of you are interested, or perhaps just for your information, beginning at 10:45 at St Mary's Church in the centre of Geelong, there will be that public Stations of the Cross, which will take place. Friends, on this day, we again gather to remember the events surrounding the crucifixion of Jesus, and in so doing, ponder in our hearts its significance for us and for the world. As we have before, we will follow a version of the Tenebrae, the service of the shadows, during which we will hear this year passages from the Gospel set down in the lectionary, Mark's Gospel. We will share in some reflective silence, and we will extinguish candles. At the end of the service, well, just before the end of the service, we'll hear some reflective music. Some of you have heard it before. It's that wonderful piece by the Ukrainian choir that Robin found for us. So we'll sit through that, and then I will take the candle from this space. And you are invited to leave quietly and prayerfully, and you're welcome to stay in the silence as long as you like, if you wish. Let's share in the opening prayer, which is actually on the screen. Lord, draw us to your cross, which brings forgiveness. Lord, draw us to your cross, which brings healing. Lord, draw us to your cross, which brings hope. Lord, draw us to your cross, which brings love. Lord, draw us to your cross, which brings light. Lord, draw us to your cross, which brings life, that we may live for you. Amen. Let's sing the hymn, In the Cross of Christ I Glory. As I said before, this year we'll be using some passages from Mark's account of Jesus' passion. The words will not be on the screen, but we'll be using the Good News translation for nearly all of the readings. So if you want to follow along, there are Good News Bibles in the pews. And we're beginning our reading at Mark chapter 14, which is on page 67. So if anyone wants to follow along in their Bibles, that's page 67 in the New Testament section, Mark chapter 14 from about verse 22. We'll be following it through in a few moments. Someone has described Mark's gospel as an extended passion narrative with an introduction. Mark's account of the week beginning with Jesus' entry into Jerusalem up until his description of Jesus' crucifixion, which is chapters 11 to 15 of Mark's gospel, takes up about 40% of the gospel, 40% of the words of the gospel. Indeed, all four gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, offer us lengthy accounts of the events that mark Jesus' last week in Jerusalem. This in itself indicates how important these last days were to the first Christians. Each gospel writer is genuinely an evangelist. They want us to open our hearts and embrace the meaning of these events for us and for the world. They want us to recognise the power and significance of what took place. Let me just briefly, as an introduction, share with you a few elements and themes that have been prompted for me by reading through Mark's Passion narrative. We've spoken a number of times in the past here, as we've been journeying through Mark's Gospel, about the way everything in Mark's Gospel happens with great haste. Immediately Jesus does this, or immediately he travels somewhere. All this kind of slows down in the Passion narrative, in the final hours before Jesus' death. Mark gives us time to reflect and gives us detail. Also, what's clear from all four Gospels, and particularly in Mark's Gospel, is the fact that Jesus had constantly tried to get through to his disciples the reality of what was to befall him, but they did not get it, and they don't get it in his final days. They remain confused, amazed. Amazed, by the way, is a word in Mark's gospel which means sort of not in touch with what Jesus is on about. New Testament scholar Brendan Byrne describes Mark's account of Jesus' death as the most stark and unrelieved gospel account. There's nothing varnished about it. Clearly, Jesus is not play-acting. This is genuine. He is not just seeming to suffer and die. In the words of Charles Wesley in his famous hymn, "'Tis mystery all, the immortal dies." Mark describes, like the other gospel writers, how various forces sought to do away with Jesus because he posed a challenge and threat to their power and status. The Roman authorities and the religious leaders of Jesus' day were prepared to collude. They didn't always get on at all, but they were prepared to collude in arranging Jesus' murder so that they could wash their hands of this man who challenged them with the truth that they did not want to hear. As Henry II of England is reputed to have said regarding the Archbishop of Canterbury of his day, Thomas Becket, "Who will rid me of this troublesome priest? Just get rid of Jesus, then we can move on." Jesus, of course they were so wrong. Jesus is, as you'll hear, is very much the centre of the events in the way Mark describes his last days. And he becomes increasingly alone. Nearly all of his followers desert him, although Mark writes of a group of mainly women who watch the crucifixion from some distance, a small group of his female disciples. They watched, all the others had fled. on the cross, it would seem that even God has left him, as Jesus cries out in dereliction the words from Psalm 22, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And yet we know that God has not forsaken him, that God is right there in the midst of it all. Just as God is right in the midst of suffering and pain today. Here in this horrible place, so starkly described by Jesus, we see the depth of the love of the true God, the God who has come amongst us in Jesus. So I leave you with a question. What does all this mean for you? Let's now prayerfully listen to sections of Mark's account. As you listen, perhaps a phrase or some element of the narrative will jump out for you, will strike you, perhaps in a way that it hasn't before. Just prayerfully sit with this. May the Holy Spirit direct our listening and help us to be more than observers of these events, but to recognise that we are participants. That what happened nearly 2,000 years ago on this day touches us. Let's pray. Saviour of the world, what have you done to deserve this? And what have we done to deserve you? Strung up between two criminals, cursed and spat upon, you wait for death and look for us. For us whose sin has crucified you. To the mystery of undeserved suffering, you bring the deeper mystery of unmerited love. Forgive us for not knowing what we have done. Open our eyes to see what you are doing now, as through wood and nails, you continue to disempower depravity and to transform us by your grace. And we pray in your name. Amen. We're going to sing again. This is a hymn attributed to Bernard of Clairvaux, who was born in about 1091. It's set to music by Bach. As you sing it, try to be conscious of the contents of the lyrics. We'll stand for this hymn, but after this hymn, we'll remain seated for the other hymns that we will sing, which we'll sing portions of actually through the service. But let's stand now and sing, O Sacred Head.
Thank you. Jesus eats the Last Supper with his disciples. While they were eating, Jesus took a piece of bread, gave a prayer of thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. "Take it," he said. "This is my body." Then he took a cup, gave thanks to God, and handed it to them. And they all drank from it. Jesus said, "This is my blood, which is poured out for many. My blood, which seals God's covenant. I tell you, I will never again drink this wine until the day I drink the new wine in the kingdom of God." Then they sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives.
Jesus prays in Gethsemane. The time came to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, Sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John with him. Distress and anguish came over him, and he said to them, "The sorrow in my heart is so great that it almost crushes me. Stay here and keep watch." He went a little further on, threw himself on the ground, and prayed that, if possible, he might not have to go through this time of suffering. "Father," he prayed, "my Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want."
Jesus is betrayed and arrested. Jesus was still speaking when Judas, one of the 12 disciples, arrived. With him was a crowd armed with swords and clubs and sent by the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders. The traitor had given the crowd a signal: "The man I kiss is the one you want. Arrest him and take him away under guard." As soon as Judas arrived, he went up to Jesus and said, "Teacher," and kissed him. So they arrested Jesus and held him tight. But one of those standing there drew his sword and struck the high priest's slave, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus spoke up and said to them, "Did you have to come with swords and clubs to capture me as though I were an outlaw? Day after day I was with you teaching in the temple, and you did not arrest me, but the scriptures must come true." Then all the disciples left him and ran away. A certain young man dressed only in a linen cloth was following Jesus. They tried to arrest him, but he ran away naked, leaving the cloth behind.
Jesus appears before the council and Pontius Pilate. Then Jesus was taken to the high priest's house, where all the chief priests, the elders, and the teachers of the law were gathering. The high priest stood up in front of them all and questioned Jesus, "Have you no answer to the accusation they bring against you?" But Jesus kept quiet and would not say a word. Again, the high priest questioned him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed God?" "I am," answered Jesus. "And you will all see the Son of Man seated at the right side of the Almighty and coming with the clouds of heaven." The high priest tore his robes and said, "We don't need any more witnesses. You heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" They all voted against him. He was guilty and should be put to death. Early in the morning, the chief priests met hurriedly with the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole council, and made their plans. They put Jesus in chains, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "So you say." The chief priests were accusing Jesus of many things, so Pilate questioned him again, "Aren't you going to answer? Listen to all their accusations." Again, Jesus refused to say a word, and Pilate was amazed. At every Passover festival, Pilate was in the habit of setting free any one prisoner the people asked for. At that time, a man named Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder in the riot. When the crowd gathered and began to ask Pilate for the usual favour, he asked them, "Do you want me to set free for you the King of the Jews?" He knew very well that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him because they were jealous. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to ask instead that Pilate set Barabbas free for them. Pilate spoke again to the crowd, "What then do you want me to do with the one you call the King of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" "But what crime has he committed?" Pilate asked. They shouted louder, "Crucify him!" Pilate wanted to please the crowd, so he set Barabbas free for them. Then he had Jesus whipped and handed him over to be crucified.
Jesus is crucified. On the way, they met a man named Simon, who was coming into the city from the country, and soldiers forced him to carry Jesus' cross. Simon was from Cyrene and was the father of Alexander and Rufus. They took Jesus to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There, they tried to give him wine mixed with a drug called myrrh, but Jesus would not drink it. Then they crucified him and divided his clothes among themselves, throwing dice to see who would get which piece of clothing. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The notice of the accusations against him said, "The King of the Jews." They also crucified two bandits with Jesus, one on his right, the other on his left. People passing by shook their heads and hurled abuse at Jesus. "Aha, you're going to tear down the temple and build it back up in 3 days. Now come down from the cross and save yourself."
Jesus dies on the cross. At noon, the whole country was covered with darkness, which lasted for 3 hours. At 3 o'clock, Jesus died, cried out with a loud shout, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why did you abandon me?" Some of the people there heard him and said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." One of them ran up with a sponge, soaked it in a cheap wine, and put it on the end of a stick. Then he held it up to Jesus' lips and said, "Wait, let us see if Elijah is coming to bring him down from the cross." With a loud cry, Jesus died. The curtain hanging in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The army officer who was standing there in front of the cross saw how Jesus had died. "This man was really the Son of God," he said. Some women were there looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of the younger James and of Joseph, and Salome. They had followed Jesus while he was in Galilee and helped him. Many other women who had come to Jerusalem with him were there also.
Jesus is laid in the tomb. It was toward evening when Joseph of Arimathea arrived. He was a respected member of the council who was waiting for the coming of the kingdom of God. It was preparation day, that is, the day before the Sabbath. So Joseph went boldly into the presence of Pilate and asked him for the body of Jesus. Pilate was surprised to hear that Jesus was already dead. He called the army officer and asked him if Jesus had been dead a long time. After hearing the officer's report, Pilate told Joseph he could have the body. Joseph bought a linen sheet, took the body down, wrapped it in the sheet, and placed it in a tomb which had been dug out of solid rock. Then he rolled a large stone across the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, were watching, and saw where the body of Jesus was placed. The suffering servant. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed.
Thank you.
God of mystery and wonder. Because we know the ending of the story, it's tempting for us to ignore the darkness of this day. It's tempting for us to go about our business as usual. It's tempting for us to move too quickly to the dawn of light on Easter morning. But give us courage and strength on this day to live for a while in the darkness, to feel the darkness in which so many of your children dwell, the darkness into which your Son Jesus entered. As we ponder the suffering of Christ, help us to recognize that he did it for us and for all, and that through his suffering you share with all who suffer in this world. So on this day, marked by suffering and death, we pray for all who suffer and who are touched by death, known and unknown to us. We give thanks, living God, that through Jesus you meet us with a love that will never let us go. You deal with the sin of the world. You utter words of mercy and forgiveness that heal our brokenness. You offer new beginnings where we had expected only dead ends. We give you thanks and praise for the mystery of your suffering love that gives us life. We give you thanks and praise that you know our weakness and hear our prayers. We give you thanks and praise that all our dying and living is held in your good keeping. So on this, the darkest of days, we pray the kingdom prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.